Hey, pilots! Welcome to another exciting episode of War Robots Domination, a series of helpful gameplay tutorials designed to help highlight the tactics and strategies that I use to help tip the scales in my favorite game, War Robots. Each episode will feature a handful of battles along with helpful commentary that'll provide insight as to what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. I'm your host, Gotchure Beacons, and I've been playing this awesome game for a few years now, and I've learned a few tricks along the way that I'd love to share with y'all. You'll notice that although my hangar is fairly basic and at lower levels, I've been able to climb it up to Expert League, so I believe that you'll find my tactics will help you do more with less, which could be very helpful with today's economy in the game. I should also mention that this is my second account, so don't let my career profile stats fool you. This is actually my baby account, but it sends a great message to pilots who feel they need to chase the current meta in order to be competitive in battle, because you don't. Wise gameplay can usually overcome any fancy gimmick. A death button is a great example. It can still melt just about any build, and its heritage stems all the way back to near the beginning of the game. It's all about knowing when to use it and how to use it. So, without further ado, I invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episodes while I walk you through my gameplay tactics and share with you my mindset in battle. I hope you find it entertaining, helpful, and fun to watch. I think you will. Let's start this show by introducing the boys that make all the noise, my wrecking crews. We got the old guard and the new recruits. Let's start with the new recruits. These boys are fresh on the scene. First, we got Stinger, my Exodus Pinata Strider. And then we got Flash, my Gust Halo Pursuer. And then we got Jumpstart, my Talumba Calamity Inquisitor. And then we got Freezer Burn, my Shredder Ember Mercury. And then we got Major Pain, my beautiful Zeus Fury. Now these bots are all level 6, the weapons are anywhere from 7 to 9. And then we got the old guard, everyone's favorite. Don't forget about them, they're part of the show. First we got Frick, my death button raven with Orkins and Panadas. And then we got his twin brother Crack, my Russian death button raven with Talumbas and Pins. And then we got the general with my beautiful Trident Fury. And then we got Reaper, my Avenger Bulwark. And then we got everyone's favorite Buzzkill, my Spark Scorched Mender. Now these bots are a level 6 and all their weapons are at level 9. Now these boys have climbed their ranks all the way up to Master 3, so make sure you cheer them on out there in the battlefield because they're fighting way above their weight class. Alright guys, let's get this party started. I'm going to call this battle Honey Badger, and man, you're going to see why here in a second. Enjoy my friends in the background and status as they play their awesome song War, perfect for this battle. So, I actually have the Beacon Rush lineup here in my hangar, and I pushed Domination. But you know what? It works out great for this map, because with Rome, you really don't need a general. What you need is you need basically a Beacon Rush hangar, so this worked out great. So I open up with Frick. He's my death button raven. The double jump allows him to go to either side. Once I get to the backside of the Colosseum, I just basically have to let him charge up his double jump, and then I can go right or left. It makes a lot of sense in this case to go left, so I did, and I'm kind of guarding this beacon. But he's getting chipped away really quick-like. So now I'm going to hop into my next bot here, and this is going to be Reaper. He's also a high-damage bot with those double Avengers. And 500 meters allows them to start chipping away. Now, they are definitely coming on strong. They're up 4 beacons to 1. You know, and that's why I'm calling this battle Honey Badger. I'm not sure if you ever watched that little video about the Honey Badger, but the Honey Badger, they don't give a rip about nothing. They don't care if they get stung by a snake. They'll just take a nap and then get back up and keep going. And then they'll eat the snake. And then they'll pass out from the poison, and they'll get back up and keep going. Because Honey Badger, don't give a rip. I'm paraphrasing. So, right now, we are a bunch of Honey Badgers. I tell you what, each and every guy, each and every pilot on my team right now, we're a bunch of, look at us now, 4 beacons to their 1. We don't give a rip. Honey Badger, don't give a rip. You just keep it coming. We got this. We are just tearing into these guys. They're tearing into us, but we don't care. We don't give a rip about nothing. Honey Badger don't care. He's just gonna come on back. Look at little Buzzkill here. He buzzes and he kills you. He's charging right into the face of death. You wanna know why? Cause he's a little Honey Badger. He don't care. He's just gonna rip right into them. He's gonna come right on back. Nope, those are our beacons. Now we are up 4 beacons to your 1. Bring it on. We got this. You give us whatever you got. We don't care. Cause Honey Badger, he just don't give a rip. Hey, you can insert the, your own words if you want to from the video there. But anyway, I'm going to keep it clean. So we are at 4 beacons to 1. My little honey badger here. He is my little, Buzzkill is my little honey badger. He don't care. He'll charge in anyone. I am looking for anyone who's threatening. So someone's coming to the center right there. So I'm just going to go ahead and start marching him down. Hit my little module. You can hit me all you want with your Orkins. Guess what? You just died. Because Buzzkill, he's a little honey badger. He don't give a rip. All right, guys, so we are still up 4 beacons to 1. They're coming back, but it's going to be a little bit too late. I'm going to go ahead and module on up. Not module, but, you know, hit the repair. Come back, get these guys. Take this one last guy out. We're going to go get that beacon, but it's already, you can already see where the beacon bar is. It's a little too late for these reds. They tried hard, but, man, we're just a whole bunch of little honey badgers out there, and we don't give a rip. You bring it. We're going to get you right on back. And that was a whole lot of fun. Hey, we got great pilots on both sides. We got masters and experts. Everyone knows what they're doing. It looks like one of the guys on their team did drop out. He did get 4 beacons, so it wasn't like he was sitting around tanking. He was going after beacons, not putting out a lot of damage. But it don't matter. We were just charging in full on. We didn't give a rip. We were just a bunch of little honey badgers. So if you see your name, thanks for the game. Peace out. I'm going to call this battle Tough Lesson. And it is, but stick around, and it's a good one. Enjoy my friends in the background and status as they play their awesome song, Theta. You know, I love this game. I'm sure you hear it in my voice. It's not made up. I absolutely think this is one of the best games out there because there's so much things going on from a tactical standpoint, from a camaraderie standpoint, from a challenge standpoint, you know, from an option standpoint, you know, all sorts of choices and everything else. There's so much different reasons to love this game, and it does bring different aspects for different kinds of people out there too. But, you know, I just like, you know, getting on the field with, you know, basically 11 other pilots. Some are on my side, some are on their side, and we're all just giving it, you know. And with the way this works, you don't really know who you're gonna go with. You're playing solo. You're gonna get matched up with people on both sides. You know, I read a lot of complaints about on Facebook about matchmaking and how it doesn't do a very good job and all, and that is absolutely correct. You know, this isn't a perfect matchmaking system. It's just the way it is. It's part of the game, though. So remember that when you're in a battle, you're not in with a perfectly balanced battle all the time. Sometimes they are, but sometimes they're not. And to be honest with you, I truly believe that matchmaking is designed to thread in some challenge, some frustration. They do want you to spend money and to level up your hangers. So to do that, they basically sometimes will put you at a disadvantage. But it's not always just matchmaking. Sometimes it's just a matter of, you know, who is on your team and what they're into. Some are into lowering their levels, so they lose intentionally. They call that tanking. It's to try to bring their rank down to put them against easier opponents. Some lose connection. So there's all sorts of other variables that go into each battle, and you just need to remember that. Don't take anything personal on this game. Always go in with your best intentions. Always go in trusting your mates and trusting your team. Always go in with the mindset of winning. Always go in to play your best. And that's all you have control over. Don't worry about matchmaking. Don't worry about even so much the outcome of the battle, because a lot of times it's not in your hands. This is not 1 versus 1. This is 6 versus 6. There's a lot of chance that goes into these games. And because of that, you really can't take the losses personal, because it's not 1 versus 1. All you can really do is go in and play your best. You know, use your good mindset, use your good tactics, do your best to deploy the bots in the right order, to grab beacons when you can, to team up when you can, to make sure you're backing your mates, and do everything that you can to affect the team, to affect the win, to do your best to support your mates. And that's really all you are responsible for. You're not responsible for what your teammates do. You're not responsible for matchmaking. You're not responsible for putting everything together perfectly. Now, so because of that, you really can't take ownership of a loss. And try not to do that. If you are playing your best and you know you played a solid game and you did know you did everything you needed to do to put that game into a victory standpoint and to give your team the best advantage you could, don't take the losses personal, because you did what you needed to do. Unfortunately, other things that are out of your control were working against you. And if that's the case, then you really can't take ownership of the losses. So I've been playing through with the new recruits here. I've been doing a fairly good job of keeping them blue. I've been doing a very good job of whittling them down. There's been maybe one or two slight occasions where I could have done it a slightly better, but for the most part, I'm really doing my best to support my team and go after the Reds and keep them blue. And it looks like for the most part, my team has been doing a fairly good job too. But I'm also looking at the body count, and I can see that we're starting to mech out. And when you start meching out with a couple minutes left, it's definitely an opportunity for them to have a power play on the beacons. They can start cleaning up because they're able just to cover more ground than your team is, because there are more of them than there are of you. And it might start showing up on the beacon bar. It just depends on their tactics and what they do, and if they start focusing on beacons or if they're trying to just mech you out. If they do that, then you might have a chance. We are ahead on beacon bar. We are ahead on beacons right now, but there's still a minute left. And we'll just start seeing how things pan out. Here, I'm gonna try to take this guy out. I know that the guy behind me was gonna be taken out by my mate, I thought. So I was just gonna go ahead and take after the bigger threat here. He's got a way of getting me down, but I'm gonna try to see if I can get behind some structure here. Again, do my best. And there we go. Now I'm gonna go over here. I'm gonna probably hit a module and see if I can't make this one blue. But I can see already by looking around and looking that they're getting ready to cap the third beacon. So now they're up three beacons to R2 with only 6 minutes, seconds left. I know that we aren't gonna get this one. So it was a tough loss. It really was. But boy, oh boy, let's take a look at the stats. I broke a million. I had another guy on my team that broke a million. We had no one on the other team that broke a million. But they had some really good beacon runners. We did some pretty good beacon runners ourselves, but as you can see at the bottom, there's a guy that only got less than 100,000 or less than 200,000, 127,000, didn't get a beacon, only got one kill, probably was doing the tanking thing, and as a result, it put us just a slight disadvantage against them. And with them having some really good beacon runners, that's what happened. Hey, if you see your name, thanks for the game. Peace out. I'm calling this week's Beacon Rush Battle, Give It Your All. I'll definitely explain why here in a second. Enjoy my friends in the background and status as they play their awesome song, November. So again, I'm going to try to put in Beacon Rush Battles on a regular basis on my episodes. I think it's a fun mode. It's definitely different than what I'm used to, but it's certainly something that I can certainly help you with and share some mindsets with you. So maybe give you some tips. So this is Frick. He is my death button raven. Again, a beacon rush hanger really needs to be a lot of high output, high DPS, damage per second bots, with hopefully some speed on them as well. So Frick is definitely one of those. I tried to take that one up there and I didn't. But the idea behind beacon rush is to try to close the gap between you and their actual spawn point. You do that by going after beacons that are as close to them as possible. So we're rushing right on up. Rather than a three and hold, which is definitely kind of what you want to do, but you definitely want to take advantage of every little space that you can and close that gap on their spawn beacon. And that's really what you want to do. So if you have a chance to get one of these neutral beacons or one closer to the spawn, man, you jump on that opportunity, because then your mates can start spawning in that point. So that was Flashy got taken out. And by the way, I'm not sure if you saw, but Flashy got some pretty formidable bots before going down. And this is part of the other thing that you need to remember in Beacon Rush. They're not gonna be 10-minute battles like Domination. You have to do some recklessness, some sacrificing. You gotta give it your all. Sometimes you're gonna have to kind of run into death because you know your mates are right behind you. And that's the thing, is unlike Domination, your mates are in right behind you because they're able to spawn right in behind you, as opposed to way back at their at your normal spawn point. So make sure you're taking advantage of that. Try your best to hold the beacons that you have. When you're deciding where to deploy your next bot, kind of be mindful of that. Go with where some of your mates are, but also go where you're gonna have an advantage and not get jumped right in and around a bunch of Reds where you're jumping right on into certain depth. Doesn't do you any good. So be very, very careful about that. Now, this is an invader. Invader's very, very tough. I could probably, I tell you what, right here I was in a crossroads, because I didn't want to let that guy get that one, but I knew if I jumped right up, he'd get me. And he's right behind that post. And I was just feeling kind of like, what do I do? What do I do? Now I've let my team down. I really wasn't feeling good. So I hopped into Buzzkill, everyone's favorite. He's my little assassin. He might get that guy, he might not. Now watch what's gonna happen here. You know that they're gonna spawn right where they can get you. So, guess what? I learned that trick from you, buddy. I'm going right behind a post. Now, I'm in Buzzkill. He buzzes, and then he kills you. And that's my little payback. I'm gonna get my beacon back, because I kinda dropped the ball and let it go back behind. Now I'm gonna go over here. Now, again, it's all about learning how to do things and your timing and stuff like that. I make another little mistake with Buzzkill here. What I should be doing is charging up his weapons and holding his regeneration right there. Because then this guy did a very smart thing. He popped out right there and took me out. Now, if I had not used my mending ability and waited right then, I could have weathered that storm and actually liberated that beacon. Now, another one of my baits got him back, but see now, we're not at a disadvantage. We're mecking them out, so that's good. And that's gonna happen in a lot of your beacon rushes. You're gonna mech them out. But always be looking to fill that gap. With two of those guys over there, I'm gonna go over here and try to take this beacon. And again, it's all about timing. See, as soon as someone dies, they're gonna pop right up by one of their things, so be mindful of that. I probably should not have jumped. I probably should have saved my jump, where it would have given me some stealth. But luckily, that was my last spot, but I had another guy right behind me, and he was able to take advantage of what I had set up. And there we go, with our nice green banner at the end. So, make sure you're giving it your all out there. Be very, very mindful of the timing, and always be ready to have your pounce. You know, your pounce ability, whether it be a stealth with all your weapons charged up or something like that. Because you know this is the kind of bot hanger you want to have out there, is ones that are basically explosive bots. So make sure that your explosion is ready as soon as you're approaching a red territory, because they're going to spawn right on top of you guys. So hey, hope you learned something there. If you see your name, peace out. Thanks so much for the game. Well, friends, that just about wraps it up for another episode. Thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed what you saw and are able to take something you learn and use it in battle. I add content to my YouTube channel almost daily, so please stop by when you're able and check out the fresh new material. Or just click on an old episode and maybe catch another tip that'll help you up your game. If you like what you see, please tap on the red subscription button and then tap the bell to be notified when new episodes are released. It would also be helpful if you could make a comment about the video, whether it's an example of how the episode helped you, or maybe additional advice to help elaborate on the tactics I shared, or even constructive comments that'll help clarify something I might have missed. It's all good and greatly appreciated. Finally, this game is full of challenges and can create frustration for some who are simply trying to have fun with this awesome game. My goal is to provide you all with helpful information and help reduce the frustration and increase the fun. So, if you feel these videos are helping you, please share them with a friend, someone who you think might benefit from them. Well, that's about it for today, guys. As always, keep them blue out there, and I hope to see you on the battlefield. Make sure you're having fun, though, because if you're not, you're doing it wrong. I love you all for your support. Play well. Peace out.